Yeah, since all good things come in threes, there's GPT version 3. So this is the last model in this GPT saga. So GPT-3 is again much larger than the previous model. So it's instead of 1.5 billion, it's now 175 billion parameters. And if you're again interested in more details, there is the paper here on archive. So again, in this video, we will have only a very short summary, and details can be found in this paper. It's actually a very long paper. I think it was like 40 or 50 pages. So have fun. Okay. So the architecture overall is again overall similar to GPT version 2, but of course it's now much bigger. So there are also more layers and so forth. They also doubled the context size. So instead of having 2024 input tokens, they have now 2048. The word embeddings are also substantially larger. So instead of 1.6 thousand, they now have approximately 12,800. And they also, to make things feasible computationally, they use this attention pattern from the sparse transformer. Yeah, because attention scales quadratically, it's quite expensive. So they borrowed some concepts from a sparse transformer, which is again something we won't go into too much detail, but here is the name of the paper if you want to read up on more details about this sparse transformer architecture. Okay, so the data sets are also substantially larger. So they had in the GPT version 2, if you recall, this web text data set consisting of, I think it was 8 million websites or documents. So they have now a version 2 of that with 19 billion tokens. So they didn't say how many tokens were in web text 1, so I'm not sure how much bigger it is, but sounds big, 19 billion. They have an even bigger data set called Crom and Crawl, 410 billion. They have book data sets, and they also still have that Wikipedia data set. Here are just some weighting, how much weight these data sets had in the total training procedure. Then this implicit task learning. So they say essentially that when they are doing the unsupervised pre-training, the self-supervised learning here, they call that the outer loop. So it's just a regular training. And they make the argument that while they are doing that, because of the rich information in these texts, implicitly the model learns or does this so-called in-context learning, where it sees examples like this and so forth. So like spelling corrections and these types of things. And yeah, there are these in-context learning tasks. Now, then again, they don't use any fine-tuning similar to GPT version 2. So again, in GPT version 1, they used fine-tuning after the pre-training. In GPT version 2, they got rid of it. And also in GPT version 3, they don't use any fine-tuning. However, in GPT version 2, they only used this zero-shot transfer to provide context. Now they, in addition to that, also have one-shot and few-shot contexts where they at least provide some examples of the task to the model. So for instance, in GPT version 2, a task in the zero-shot transfer may look like this, where you have the prompt or description, sorry, the description, translate English to French, colon, this is the input. Together, you provide also the prompt as the input, like cheese and then an arrow, and then it should learn how to translate the word cheese into the French version, which I, by the way, don't know. In any case, so and then in this one-shot one, they would at least provide one example. So they still have this task description, but also as an example, they provide this translation from sea otter to, I don't even want to try to pronounce it because I know it would be ridiculous when I try because unfortunately I don't speak French. But the point here is that they provide an example of what the model is attempting or should attempt to do. And then in few shot, they provide multiple examples. They say they provide as many examples as can be fit into the context, and it's usually around 10 to 100 examples. So for instance, sea otter, peppermint, plush giraffe, and so forth. And then this is the prompt for the model again. And again, here in contrast, the traditional fine-tuning, for example, in GPT version 1, you would provide examples, then do a gradient descent update, provide examples, gradient descent update. This would be essentially supervised learning. They don't do that in GPT version 3 though, they just use these contexts as input, and the model should figure out by itself what to do essentially. And yeah, they found that providing more examples helps with model performance. So at the bottom here, that's the zero shot, and the x-axis here, that's the number of parameters, so from small model to a large model. And you can see consistently that one shot and few shot is an improvement over zero shot. So there's almost like a constant improvement if you use multiple examples as input. And you can see when you train a very large language model like this one here and have this few shot examples, it can, on a trivia question answering task, even outperform the previous state of the art, which is quite impressive. Because it's not trained for question answering, it's essentially figuring it out by itself by looking at a few examples. Okay, yeah, and this was already GPT version 3. So essentially it was about making the model larger and also providing these one-shot and few-shot examples in addition to zero-shot. Okay, so next, this is actually an older model. It's from 2019, I think, but it's quite interesting because it combines both BERT and GPT concepts.